Welcome everyone here. We're now ready to begin with our opening song. It can be found in the hymnal, the missalette at the end of the pews, on Eagle's Wings, number 722. As we gather, we recognize God in our midst, and so we pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace and peace of God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and with your spirit. In the waters of baptism, Carl died with Christ and rose with him to new life, may he now share with Christ in his eternal glory. On the day of his baptism, he was given the white garment that marked the outward sign of his life with Christ. We place the pall on the casket as a sign of our hope and prayer that he shares that life now forever with God.
Please be seated for a moment. First of all, I want to thank Father Dan. You have granted a dying man his wishes. I want to offer my deepest sympathy to Jan and to Nicole and Josh, Alex and Audrey, to Josh and Kelsey in Texas, and Caitlin and Carissa, and to Carol's grandchildren, Elizabeth, Austin, Louisa, Henry, Ibby, and William. And of course to you, Phyllis, Carol's mother, and brothers, Greg, Jeff, and Ken, and to Kathy. My name is Father Michael Moore, and you've known Carol all your lives. I knew Carol only from last August when he was sick and I was visiting. And we did develop a friendship, a deep friendship, very quickly. And we talked about movies like Braveheart, Gladiator, The Vikings. We talked about football, a team in Pittsburgh. I talked about Irish football. And then we talked about family. And I can tell you, Carol did not fear dying. That was not his worry. His biggest worry was leaving you, his family. And he said that straight out. And I think you know, without me telling you, the depth of his love for you. I also know your depth of love for him. And I'll just quote what a man once said to me, "Tears are holy water. Tears are holy water. They are an indication of the depth of our love for a person who's passed away." And I do pray now that rest, that Carol rests in peace. Amen.
Please stand and let us pray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Carl, whom you have called to journey to you. And since he hoped and believed in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland to delight in its everlasting joys. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you kindly now to be seated as we listen to the scripture readings.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The just man, though he die early, shall be at rest. For the age that is honorable comes not with the passing of time, nor can it be measured in terms of years. Rather, understanding is the hoary crown for men, and an unsullied life the attainment of old age. He who pleased God was loved. He who lived among sinners was transported, snatched away, lest wickedness pervert his mind or deceit beguile his soul. For the witchery of paltry things obscures what is right, and the whirl of desire transforms the innocent mind. Having become perfect, in a short while he reached the fullness of a career. For his soul was pleasing to the Lord. Therefore he sped him out of the midst of wickedness. But the people saw and did not understand, nor did they take this into account. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not fall asleep, but we will all be changed in an instant, in the blink of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For that which is corruptible must clothe itself with incorruptibility, and this which is mortal must clothe itself with immortality. And when this which is corruptible clothes itself with incorruptibility, and this which is mortal clothes itself with immortality, then the word that is written shall come about. Death is swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus answered the Jews and said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes in the one who sent me has eternal life and will not come to condemnation, but has passed from death to life. Amen, amen, I say to you, the hour is coming and is now here when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, so also he gave to his Son the possession of life in himself. And he gave him power to exercise judgment, because he is the Son of God. Do not be amazed at this, because the hour is coming, in which all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and will come out, those who have done good deeds to the resurrection of life, and those who have done good deeds to the resurrection of life, but those who have done wicked deeds to the resurrection of condemnation." My friends, the Gospel of the Lord.
I also offer a word of welcome to family, to friends, to students, to all as we gather here to offer these prayers, the funeral mass for Carl. Also, I know some might be joining us by live stream, so those who cannot be here in person, we welcome you and give thanks for your thoughts and prayers here today as well. Certainly, I offer my prayers and sympathy to the family and those who knew Carl. It always strikes me that whenever somebody is taken from us in death, a family member, a loved one, someone we care about, we experience sadness, we mourn their passing, we grieve, and that's only natural, kind of our human reaction to somebody that we know about and care and love. But yet, as people of faith, we gather here today not only to weep and mourn, we gather to offer our prayers, certainly for Carl, in that hope of eternal life. We offer our support and care and love for one another. And we even come together to celebrate the goodness of his life and the blessing that he was to so many, and to celebrate our hope in eternal life for those who know and serve the Lord. I was struck that soon after I learned about Carl's passing, you know, the wonders of social media. It wasn't long after that where there was a friend, a lady that I knew from a prior assignment in Napoleon. You know, she posted on there like, oh, she remembered him back when she was in school at Napoleon, you know, and how he touched her life then. And, you know, so often we have very little clue about the lives who are touched by so many people, and indeed are seen as a blessing. So certainly that we give thanks for that. I think that also makes it harder, you know, when somebody who is so good and so such a blessing to so many, that we feel that loss, we experience that sadness and grief. So for many, when we think of Carl, we think of him as a teacher and football coach. So often, you know, you kind of have this image. I didn't play football growing up. As many of you know, I grew up in Kaleida, and we don't have football there, you know. So I never played football. But still, you have kind of this image of a football coach, you know, one who's maybe screaming and, you know, hard on the kids, making them work hard and running drills in order that they might have the conditioning and they might learn the plays and be ready for the game. You know, and maybe even like this cold, you know, is it cold out these days? You know, I imagine a football coach running around in shorts and a t-shirt. It's not cold at all. What are you complaining about? I don't know if that was Carl or not. But so you have kind of these images about football coaches, you know, ones who works with a team because he wants to make them truly keep striving to be the best that they can be. Maybe they have some goals, you know, like pain is temporary, or give all you've got, or maybe goals of winning a certain number of games or the league championship or beyond that. You know, so you have those kind of things that often are associated with football coaches at whatever level that might be. But then as I've been around Carl just a little bit, you know, it didn't take long to realize that that was only a small part of who he was, that he was such a gift, I think, certainly to family, where you saw that. You know, just even in a few of the pictures that were caught, and the family said, oh, that was only a small number that they had up and around the funeral home yesterday. That was just a small part of who he was and the ways that he interacted with you, whether it was giving rides in a wheelbarrow, you know, or fishing or whatever, you know, the things that really spoke about his great love and care for family. And the other thing that struck me was his deep faith. So I also remember when I first came to this assignment here at St. Mary's and St. Joseph and Blakesley and St. Michael in Hicksville, that Carl was a lector, a reader there at St. Joseph. Often when he got up to read, I thought, well, people would be able to hear him, you know, because he spoke, you know, pretty loudly, you know, and did a nice job, you know. So that, and then even as Father Michael mentioned, as he battled with cancer, you just kept seeing him keep struggling and fighting and, you know, not so much for himself. I mean, he wanted to keep on living, but more for the family. And I saw his deep faith. You know, like everybody, we sort of question, why does he have to go through the suffering and pain, and why is he afflicted with cancer? But yet I saw his deep faith. You know, at Christmas he was at Mass, and he even in the last week or two, you know, whenever, if he could possibly get out of bed, you know, he was here in church. And just saw that as an important part. Now, also, as I learned from the family, maybe he would sit there sort of, you know that he was kind of wondering about how long we would go, or he was anxious to, you know, to maybe just recite things and not sing everything, and, you know, to keep it moving along, a part that I had never known about him. You know, those things that happen back in church that I don't observe or see all the time. But so still, he just had that deep faith, that love for God, and, you know, the family also expressed that when we met. You know, that he just had that deep faith. So we gather, you know, with those and all of you that have so many other memories, obviously are all part of the cues or the idea of just what a terrific man Carl was, and indeed what a blessing he was to so many. Now, I think sometimes, you know, as we live in this world, we struggle with the ideas of illness and suffering. You know, it's like, and that's a question or a struggle that people of all times and places have struggled with. You know, it's like, especially somebody who's good and just and a blessing, you know, why on earth would he be afflicted with cancer or some other illness or suffering? It's like one thing if it was somebody who was bad and rotten, like, okay, they deserve it. You know, but that's often not the case. You know, and so those are over and over just things that remind us that we live in an imperfect world. That there is disease, there is suffering, there are accidents, you know, and those kind of things. And when you think about all of that, and just even the human body, of how complex and incredible we are, it's pretty amazing that any of us walk around sort of healthy, at least some of the times. You know, and so again, we live in that imperfect world and experience at times those trials, those sufferings, those things that are just hard for us to understand and explain. But yet, as we gather here, we also come together looking to the scriptures, the word of God, those things of inspiration that also have been a source of comfort and blessing for people throughout the ages. So first, we heard from the reading from the Book of Wisdom from the Old Testament, and it talks about how the just man, though he die early, shall be at rest. And it talks about how him striving for this hoary crown. It's like, what is that? You know, so wisdom, in the Old Testament, wisdom often associates wisdom and understanding with God. And so that was their kind of goal, that sort of ancient thing of wisdom and understanding, that somehow that represented God. And so that's what they sought somehow to, okay, they even way back then, they couldn't make sense of a whole lot of things of the world, but they seek that deeper understanding and grace that came from God. That somehow that would help guide them through the uncertainties of this world, striving for ultimately, if they grew in that understanding, they believed that they would grow closer to God and proclaim those things of far greater importance than just survival or success in the ways of the world. Then in the second reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, we hear that Paul, he speaks about mortal versus immortal. Now, during Paul's time, remember that was shortly after the death and resurrection of Christ, many of the early Christians were believing that Christ would come back in their lifetime, where Jesus, before he died on the cross, promised his disciples, "I'm going away, but I'll come back to take you with me, that where I am, you also may be." You know, and so many of those early Christians thought that Jesus would come back in their lifetime. But then as the years go on and people start dying, some of them persecuted and put to death because of their faith, and many other evils and trials of the world that they faced, they started asking that question: what happens to those who have died before Christ returns? And Paul assures them also of speaking about the mortal and immortal, and somehow there's that soul or that part of the body that lives on, and that they might continue to have that faith in Jesus, and it's that faith that will lead them to everlasting life. And finally, in the Gospel of John, Jesus presents a similar message. Jesus says, "Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes in the one who sent me has eternal life." So we know that somehow through faith that Jesus came not to free us of all sufferings and uncertainties and trials in life. Rather, he came to walk with us and to assure us that any of that, suffering, death, illness, that's not the end. That through him, through Jesus, who suffered and died on the cross, showed that that wasn't the end, but that he rose again. And so he offers that hope of eternal blessedness and life with God forever. That's hope for all of us. It doesn't take away some of those questions and trials and sadness and hurt that we feel when somebody who's so good is taken from us, but somehow that continues to offer us hope as it has for people of all times and all places. So as we continue on our journey, we seek to continue to be inspired by the wisdom and understanding that was a big part of Carl. And we seek to remain close to Jesus, the one who does not take away all of our sufferings and pain, but the one who walks with us, granting us his loving peace and consolation. So united in love with one another and with God, may we also, through God's grace, reach our final goal of experiencing that blessedness and immortality, of knowing that life eternal with God and all the saints in heaven. Now please stand for our prayers of intercession. One of the ways that we as Christians show our care and love for one another is to pray for them. God, the Almighty Father, raised Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
For Carl, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, may he be raised up on the last day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased family members and loved ones, especially for Carl's dad, Richard Sonneberger, and his brother, Rick, may all the faithful departed be granted refreshment, light and peace with God in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer from cancer or other serious health issues, may Jesus grant them comfort and healing, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all teachers, coaches, and others who work with young people, may they help guide students on the path of wisdom and knowledge and help them be successful in life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Carl, may they be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you now, please, to be seated. As the bread and wine, the gifts are brought forward, we prepare for the Eucharist.
Please join in the offertory hymn number 583, Amazing Grace.
Shining as the sun.
Please stand. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Carl, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the
can kneel or be seated for the Eucharistic prayer. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Daniel, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Carl, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. When from the earth, he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters, too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes, for seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Please stand. As Jesus gathered his friends and disciples around him, they asked him, Lord, teach us to pray. So at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. And kneel or be seated. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Lead me on to the light.
About 10 years ago, I watched my dad in the spot that I am now. When that happened, there was a lot of pain and regret of words unsaid, things undone. And I didn't know how to help Dad with that. But just by the way that he always was, he helps me with that now. There's always going to be some regret of some words unsaid. But my father did everything he could to be with us all the time. He was a teacher, so we went to school with him. We went to his office at his classroom at the end of the day, rode home with him. He was a coach, so we went to practice with him. We got to spend summers with him. He would cook breakfast for us all the time, even up until the end of his sickness. He was always taking care of us. He was always with us, playing with us, whether it be in the snow, even though as he got older, he started to hate the snow, called it white dirt. He was still out there with my children and my brother's children, my sister's children, playing in the snow, helping us build ramps to make the sleds go faster. My dad hated baseball. But for hours, he would hit me a ball. He hit us all balls, mitt on one hand, bat in one hand. I still don't know how he did it. And any time we threw it past him, he would just look at us and make us go get it. I've always looked up to my dad. When I was a child, you know, I looked up to how big and strong he was, and I wanted to be like him. And people would ask me when I was a kid, oh man, it must be rough for having him as a dad. You know, he's so tough on everybody, he's always yelling. Well, those people didn't understand that his discipline was always about caring for us. He wanted us to grow up to be good people. And even when he was yelling at us or disciplining us, there was never a time when we doubted his love. It was another gesture of his love as a father. I'll tell you a story that he hated. When my brother was young and my sister was learning to drive, she went to pull the car into the van into the garage, and my brother hopped in and he stuck his arm out the window and caught it on the garage wall. When he came in and told Dad his arm was broken, Dad grabbed it, shook it, and said, "It's not broken. Go to bed." It was broken. The reason my dad hated that story, we told it all the time, mostly because my sister broke my brother's arm. But the reason my dad hated that story was because he cared so much for us. It made him sick that he had done something that caused my brother pain. He was not a callous man. He was not a cruel man. He was a loving man to his children, to my brother-in-law, my sister-in-law, my wife, who he welcomed into the family and made them feel like a part of the family. To all his players, as I grew older and our relationship moved into a friendship, I got to talk to him about football. And he loved to talk about guys who were doing well, who were scrapping, fighting, going all out. And he would He would be upset when guys weren't, when he felt like they were throwing talent away, because he cared. And he cared for my mother, enough that he had to ask her 3 times to marry him. He showed his love through service. He would take my mom's car to get gas, come back with 2 Snickers bars, one for now, one for the freezer for later. He was constantly rubbing her back, to the point where my mom or my wife asked me why I can't be more like my father. And when he got sick, he told me almost every time I saw him, take care of your mom. Because he wasn't worried about himself, ever. There was a time in the last year where I had missed a deadline at work and I was anxious. I was over at his house for dinner and he could see that I was anxious, and he asked me what was wrong, and I told him. I told him I had to leave early and go get that done. You know, such a trivial thing. And as I'm pulling an all-nighter and finishing it up, I get a text from him saying, hey, I woke up early and I did a rosary for you. That'll make it better. And it did. He spent a lot of time in the mornings doing the rosary or the Divine Mercy chaplet because it went quicker. Because he was a man of faith. He was no theologian. His was a raw faith, the childlike faith we were called upon to have. He trusted in God. He had faith in God. In times of trouble, he would yell out to God in anger, in sadness, in joy. His relationship with God the Father was reflected in our relationship with our Father. He could have lost his faith in the suffering that he went through, but when he died with that rosary in his pocket. He never lost his faith. I have been and always will be proud and honored to be the son of Carl Joseph Sonneberger. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to say is gold, go Steelers, by the way, for Dad. The games on Sunday definitely were his doing. Let me just tell you, he definitely had a part in all of that. As you got, most of you know me, I'm the oldest, even though I don't look the oldest half the time. Dad was such a great man. A lot of people, especially in my class when I was in Eden, were intimidated by him. They were scared. I remember my friends coming home and just be like, what do I do? What do I do? Am I allowed to say hi? And he'd give them a hug. They're like, oh, that was scary. Actually, he is a big old teddy bear. His bark was worse than his bite. Though sometimes he'd actually paddle us, which we deserved, but you know, we were actually more scared of Mom than we were of Dad, tell you the truth. He was always there for us. Like Alex said, even during football season, Mom would put up a sign saying, we interrupt this marriage for football season. But he was still there. He would come home, he'd still try to help us with our homework, even when, you know, a bunch of us going into more math and sciencey stuff, he would try, even though, and then he would be like, you need to ask your mother. I don't know. But he would take us to the games. He would take us to his football practices. Ever since I was really small and I was allowed to go to the football practices, I was there. I would help with the water boys. I would help with the ball boys. I learned how to do a three-point stance when I was barely one, when I could walk. He taught everybody that, even my kids. But he was perfect in my eyes. He always told me that no matter where you go, you could always come home. I've traveled the United States for jobs. I ended up in Texas for a job. My husband ended up following me down. And even though one thing would anger him, he'd always say, "You always can come home." He didn't care. He loved us. He would always love us. As when I had my first child, Elizabeth, I brought her home. I remember she was 6 weeks. I brought her home. And Dad, we get there. First thing Dad does, "Give me the baby." If she woke up in the middle of the night, he was, "I got her. Don't worry. I got her." I'm like, "Oh, okay. That's different. Okay. I can take care of her. No, I got her. You rest." He did that with my son, too. My son actually learned his football scow, which I discovered during one of these last season football games. You guys were going against one of these rough teams, and I heard my dad yelling in the box. And my son was in a grouchy mood that day, and I told him he had to stay back away from, you know, the sidelines. My son was trying to go onto the field, mind you. And you guys were down on the end, and I told him, "No, you gotta stay on this side." And he gives me this scowl that his grandpa gave everybody when he, you know, during football or when we were little, when we did something, give us a scowl. And I looked at my son and I'm like, "Where in the world did you learn that from? Like, I didn't teach it to you." But it's because my dad would always take the grandbabies when they came over and be like, "Do you want to go on a tractor ride? Do you want to go outside and feed the dogs with me?" Even when he was sick, he always took them. He always had fun with them. To go with the story that my dad always hated, my brother just told, I remember that day. I remember Dad being very angry. And later I learned he wasn't angry at me. He was scared. He was scared because my brother could have been seriously hurt. He was the father. He let me drive the van in. Ever since that day, though, I was not allowed to have any of my siblings in the vehicle to pull in the van, ever. I was not allowed. And they still blame me for his arm, even though it wasn't my fault. But he was just always there. He accepted everybody into the family. He was such a good teacher, a good football coach, good family man. I remember being in his class, 7th grade. Yes, I was in my father's social studies class. I remember before the first day of school, I looked at him, I said, "Dad, I want you to treat me like all the other students. I don't want to be singled out. I want you to treat me just like them." So we go to school. First thing I noticed is he liked to tell stories about me and my brothers. They were very embarrassing in front of my peers, and I would always slink down and be like, "Oh, please stop. Please stop. They don't need to know this." And when I would go up the one day when I needed help, I would go up and be like, he was working on something at the desk, and I went, Mr. Sonneberger, because, of course, I wanted to be treated the same. Like, Mr. Sonneberger. No answer. So I'm decided a different tactic. I'm like, coach, coach. Still no answer. Finally, I'm like, Dad. He looks up, he's like, yes. I'm like, really? But he always answered to Dad. Even if we were like down the hall and we were trying to catch up to him, we were like, Dad, he turned around. He knew our voices. He knew where we were every time of the day. When I was a freshman, I swear he told his seniors to check on me, which was annoying, I won't lie. But he, his faith, his kindness, everything about him was wonderful. And I'm gonna try to be as best as he was, even though my rosary praying is not the best. We did the rosary during Lent, and my dad heard that I was stumbling. He was laughing at me, and I'm like, Dad, it's been a while. It's been a while since I've actually sat down and prayed the whole rosary. He's like, I know. He's like, I'll help you through it, but you can't say it at this time. This is when I say it. I'm like, oh, okay. I thought you'd just say it all together, but then I learned, which is another good thing about him. He always taught us. He taught us in every different little ways, very slight things, whether it be disciplining us in church when, now that we're older, he would take our kids. I know Alex could consent to this. Take us kids and be playing with them, and we'd be like, Dad, Dad, stop. They need to pay attention. He'd be like, they're fine. And I'm like, okay, grandparents are different than parents. That's what I've been taught. They get more spoiled. There's another, and like Alex said, he got impatient during church. Ever since I was really little, growing up, I noticed the watch on his hand, a stopwatch, mind you. During homily, he'd time it. And we're like, Dad, you're not supposed to do that. He's like, I just want to see how fast they'll go this time around. And at the end of church, before the song, he always wanted to leave. I remember Mom giving him the look. When we stood up, he's like inching out of the pew, you know. He's at the end, inching out. And Mom's standing firm. She looks at him. She grabs the book, and she starts singing. And he's like, okay. So we all learned that. Traver said, okay, we got to pay attention to Mom. We got to do what Mom says. But there was times we're like, can we go? Can we go? But we also grew in his faith. A couple years ago, my faith was shaken. There was a rocky moment in my marriage, in my life. And my dad took me aside and said, everything will be okay. You are fine. You're strong. He's like, pray. Let's pray. He would always be like, I got you. Don't worry. And he'd tell me stories of when him and Mom would go through rough patches. Be like, it happens to everybody. It happens to every marriage. Don't worry. You guys get through this. You guys are tough. It's like, I see it. You guys are tough. You guys are stubborn, like me. And we did. Got through. He helped us with his, you know, his way. Trying to help us make sure we're set in our house, and coming over and teaching me how to paint properly, like Grandpa taught him how to paint. Though I am not the greatest painter. I took too much on the roll and went like this, and it came all back on me. And he looked at me, he's like, that's where I wear a hat. And I learned that trait. I learned, wear a hat when you paint the ceiling. He was just to my eyes, he was perfect. I see that in my son. I see him in my daughter, my brothers and sisters, my uncles. I'm pretty sure my uncles could tell me every story, good or bad, they've done with Dad. And I remember during some bonfires, we would have bonfires at our house. We'd get, I don't know where we would find the trees or the lumber, be stranded everywhere. We'd build a big bonfire. Even at Grandma's house, we'd be a big bonfire. And until we were old enough, Mom would, when they started drinking, Mom would have us come into bed. When we got old enough, we were allowed to stay out there and hear all these stories. And it was really nice, I mean, knowing how he was as a little kid, knowing how he was in college, in high school, learning from him, learning about their mistakes. Like when, on his honeymoon, not his honeymoon, but his bachelor party, they got so drunk, they ended up at a gay bar. He told me that one day. He said, and everybody got mad at them because they ate all the peanuts, the little peanuts they used to set out on the tables. They got mad at him. He's like, I still remember that. I might have been a little tipsy, but I still remember that. Him and Mom's love still are amazing. I look up to him and Mom in my marriage, my way of raising kids. I might seem a little strict on my kids at times, but they were strict on us, and I think we turned out okay. But I love him so much, and I'm going to miss him forever. And I just hope he stays with us in our hearts, in everybody's hearts, and shows you all the guidance he's shown me over the years. Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our brother Carl may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
May the Lord
incense the body or the casket as the incense rises up. So that's a reminder how our prayer continues to rise up to God for Carl and indeed for all of us. Also, I heard a priest explain it once a number of years ago that often the smell, the fragrance of the incense remains. So if you go back and come and return, you'll notice the smell of the incense. So it is with people. They're taken from us in death, but in our love and memory, they continue to have some influence upon us. So to you, O Lord, we commend the soul of Carl, your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead. In your sight, may he live forever. Forgive whatever sins he committed through human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now from here, we'll proceed to the cemetery. It is out at St. Joseph and Blakesley, so we'll take a little bit to get out there and off for the committal and burial, and then we'll return for a luncheon and fellowship. So you're certainly welcome to join us there. If people can't go because of the cold or whatever, you're welcome to wait here in church or in the basement till we come back and are ready to continue on the luncheon and fellowship. So in peace, we take our brother to his place of rest.
My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that all